Thank you, number one, for attending in this weather. Thank you, number two, for attending even though Pastor David's not here. But I welcome you, and so good to see you, and that you all got to safety, and that you all return home safely. Man, we're going to be low-key today. So, look at your bulletin. Read the announcements. The annual meeting is coming up. All kinds of different things going on in here. Don't forget our list of prayer concerns. Everyone, at least according to Facebook, and you know everything that's on Facebook is true. It looks like the trip to Kenya is still going well. Some really cool things happening over there. So I haven't talked with anybody or heard from anybody just through Facebook. It looks like things are going well there. So continue to keep them in your prayer as well. So at this time, let's prepare our hearts and minds for worship. Worship is printed in your bulletin. Our God is a God of power and strength.
Rise to us in your care.
Our God is a God of majesty and awe.
God walks with each of us every step of the way.
Our God is a God of glory and wonder.
God loves each of us with tenderness and passion.
Our God calls us each by name.
Our God calls us each by name and worship together.
more children here than I thought there would be. Yay! Okay, what's this? It's a bottle of water. I'm fighting to hold it. I'm going to open it and drink it soon. Of some of it. Water is, have you learned this? What part of the earth, how, what percentage of the earth is made up of water? 70-ish. They say about 75%. Like if you, in outer space, when they are like thousands of millions and billions of miles away, they look down on the earth, it's blue. Because there's that much water. Did you know that most of our body is made up of water as well? Yeah, when we are born, we're like 78% water, but as we grow and develop, it drops to like, you know, 65 or 70%. Our brain is 80% water. So water is important to us, okay? But let's talk about water. One of the things I like with water is that water changes. Like, how does this water change? How could this water change? Okay, food coloring, what else? Flavors, but even without adding, what else could this do? Like, think today, how has water changed? Think today, outside. Okay, it became snow, or sometimes it changes into ice, we use ice. What happens when it gets hot? It evaporates and creates clouds or steam, okay? So one of the cool things about water is that water changes, okay? Water also changes things. For instance, if our hands are dirty and we put water on, the dirt's gonna come off, right? Swimming. Get in a swimming pool and like the sense of gravity is so different. You can do things in a swimming pool. Hey, when I did a flip in the water every day through Bailey's pregnancy, I don't know how I could do that. When I was pregnant with her, I was in the swimming pool. Didn't matter that I was out here, I could do a flip in the water. Couldn't have done that on land. Water helps plants grow. So it starts as a seed and then it grows and it changes. Water, ice, think when you were little, and did anybody have one of those boo-boo bunnies where you had a little thing? My kids had boo-boo bunnies where you put this little plastic thing filled with water that was became ice and you put it on there to prevent the swelling. So ice helps with swelling, changes your face. Rather than having a big bruise that comes out like this, maybe the bruise is just like this. Hot water soothes our sore muscles. So that changes. So that's water change. Water itself changes, and water changes other things. And today is really Christ's baptism, the day that we recognize that. And baptism is something that changes us as well. I mean, it cleanses our sins, and we're reborn. And sometimes that's really hard for you guys to understand that at this age. But what baptism does is really change our hearts so that we can live more like Christ. And when you were little, everybody makes these promises, and your parents, and anybody else who's standing here for your parents, and everybody sitting out there. We all make promises that we are going to assist you on that way, that your heart will be changed, and that you will live more like Christ. So keep that in mind. You guys will be here for the rest of the service as we talk more about baptism and water and things like that. But just keep that in mind. So let's end with a prayer. Dear God, thank you for water. It is so useful in so many things in our life. And may we remember Jesus every time we use water and how Jesus plays a role in our life as well. And how Jesus can change our heart. Amen.
The first reading is from Isaiah chapter 43, verses 1 through 7 from the New Revised Standard Version. But now thus says the Lord, He who created you, O Jacob, He who formed you, O Israel, do not fear, for I have redeemed you. I have called you by name, you are mine. When you pass through the waters, I will be with you. And through the rivers, they shall not overwhelm you. When you walk through fire, you shall not be burned. And the flame shall not consume you. For I am the Lord your God, the Holy One of Israel, your Savior. I give Egypt to as your ransom, Ethiopia and Sabia in exchange for you. Because you are precious in my sight, and honored, and I love you. I give people in return for you. Nations in exchange for your life. I do not fear, for I am with you. I will bring your offspring from the east, and from the west I will gather up. I will say to the north, give them up, and to the south, do not withhold. Bring my sons from far away, and my daughters from the end of the earth. Everyone who is called by my name, whom I created for my glory, whom I formed and made. Holy wisdom, holy word. Please join me on page 638 in your black hymnal for the responsive sort of Psalter, and this is Psalm 29.
Water. 80%
of the world's population lives within 60 miles of the coastline of a body of water, whether that be a lake, an ocean, a river. 80% of us throughout the world live within 60 miles of a coastline. Over 500 million people owe their livelihoods directly to water. Two-thirds of the global economy is derived from activities that involve water in some form. 500 million people worldwide rely primarily on water-based sources for protein. God, I don't live in that area because I am not a fish. I don't like fish, and seafood's not my thing either. And it is interesting that water is mentioned in the Bible over 700 times. And that doesn't include when it talks about the Jordan River. The water or waters or water or something like that. It's mentioned in the Bible over 700 times. So it's kind of not surprising that water is used for baptism. You know that the water has such a role in our faith, in our baptismal faith, and so forth. I want you to think as I bring this out, because this is audience participation time. I want you to think of your water, meaning, where is your place, your go-to place for water, where everything is just, you know, that it is right to be there. That go-to place, I'll just throw some ideas out. I'll tell you where my go-to place is, and I don't need to know where everyone's go-to place is, but my go-to place is Hereford Inlet, where there is a lighthouse off by North Wildwood. Talk about that feeling. It could be in the shower. It could be when you're fishing. Because there are a lot of people who fish aren't there to fish when you think about it. So, think about where is your go-to place for water, and think about what feelings you have when you're at your go-to place. And what I'm going to ask you to is to tell me those feelings, or some of them, and we're going to put some of these up here on the board, on the paper. Now, please follow directions, because it drives me crazy at school when I tell kids I want one word and they have to give me a sentence or they have to give me a phrase. Isn't that true? Oh, it drives me crazy. So, in one word, think of that feeling you get when you are at your go-to place for work. We'll hyphenate it. I don't know, do they count hyphenated words as one word? I always love to hear, but I don't know. Anything else? Because I think this is a really good list. And I think probably all of us sitting here, when we are at our go-to place for water, could relate to this in some way. All right, get the chair out here. Whoops, I forgot that Kindles are under here. Kind of hate to sit in front of that, but all right. Could you bow your heads for prayer, please? Wise and wonderful God, take my lips and speak through them. Take our minds and think through them. Take our hearts and set them on fire to do your will. Amen. My son, Tristan, has always been fascinated with the sunrise and the sunset. And so much so that ever since he could drive, and he is 20 now, ever since he could drive, he would get up early in the mornings to go watch the sunrise. And, you know, so we're talking some mornings, that's 6 o'clock in the morning. And so there were days before school started that he would get up and go watch the sunrise or go watch the sunset. He is in Philadelphia now, and he often shows me pictures of where he rides his bike to Philly, mostly to the art museum by the Schuylkill, looks over the Schuylkill and takes pictures of the sunrise or the sunset. He has always been fascinated with that. When he goes, he's always by a body of water. It's always by the Susquehanna or the Schuylkill. He is also a risk taker. He goes wherever that is down south of the county and jumps off that big cliff and into a swimming hole. I don't know where that is. That makes me nervous. You know, I would always say, oh, you know, you're sure it's deep enough? Yes, Mom, don't worry, and all that stuff. And he comes home and says, hey, you want to see the video of me jumping? No, I don't. But anyway, he's always been fascinated with the sunrise and sunset, but always had to be around water, and he loves this place. He loves water. He called me one morning in the fall, and he never calls. My son never calls, unless it's really, really important or urgent, and he needs something now that's not very important in my book, but, and he called me one morning before I even went to school, and he was so excited, and he said, Mom, I figured out why I like water so much. And he said, have you ever heard of Blue Mind Theory? And I said, no. He said, you gotta look up Blue Mind Theory, Mom, that's me. I relate to it, it's me, it speaks to me. So I started to do some research, and he and I have gotten into this discussion about Blue Mind Theory. Here's the book. Blue Mind Theory, the surprising science that shows how being near, in, on, or underwater can make you happier, healthier, more connected, and better at what you do. It was a book written in 2014. It is a book based on neuroscience. And you know, the field of neuroscience has just expanded exponentially. I mean, it truly has. You know, before, the brain was more like one of those black boxes that you knew was in there, but you really didn't know how it operated. Now, with our advances, you can really study the brain. Before, you couldn't study the brain until somebody died. Now, and then you looked at the brain in autopsy. Now, we can study our brain with all those waves and whatever, and I don't know enough to even talk about that. But we know a lot more about our brain now. And so, this is a book that is based on neuroscience and how being near or ground water changes our brain. Neuroplasticity, that's the word nowadays. We probably didn't have that word 10 or 20 years ago, but now we have that word, neuroplasticity, of how things change. So here's what the book says. First of all, blue mind is that mildly meditative state that we get when we're in by the water. Which kind of, this is what most of these words were, kind of that mildly meditative state where we're exposed to water, where we get a sense of calm. There's cognitive and behavioral health change in benefits. For instance, brain research shows that closest to water floods our brain with those feel-good hormones, which are dopamine, serotonin, and oxytocin. Those are natural hormones in our body that are those happy hormones. And that when we are close to water, our body starts flowing, our brain starts flowing with those happy hormones, those feel-good hormones. Being exposed to water also decreases cortisol, which is considered the stress hormone. So being around water decreases our stress and increases everything else. Uninteresting. Also, brain research shows that blue is the color that is most preferred than any other color. And that's how they came up with the blue mind theory. They talk also about the red mind, and think about red. Red is that color, like, you know, the stop, and red is that, when they talk about the red mind, they talk about stress-filled mind. So that's how they came up with blue mind, because blue is the color that most people prefer than all others. It triggers a response that, like I said, you're just kind of in the right place. Feel good, that's where you need to be at that moment, and you know that. It is, water increases our ability to focus. It like vacuums all the stress out of our body and out of our brains, out of our minds. They talk about a sense of awe, A-W-E, you know. When we experience that stress of awe when we are at our go-to place for water, it changes us from a me perspective to a we perspective. And so things like it creates a neurological boost for compassion, it builds trust, promotes healing, increases creativity, increases productivity, relaxation, solitude. And one of the other statistics that has been offered is that 60% of our ailments that we have are stress induced. 60% are stress induced. So again, being around water would not only help our level of stress, but you would think would help decrease some of the diseases and illnesses and so forth. People become more generous when they're around water. Nostalgic, there's a lot of romance, you know, around water, whatever. But when you look at the researcher, his name is Wallace Nichols, and there are some TED Talks that he's done and other videos that he's done. And the point that he makes in all of this is that the core of it all is love by generating more compassion and empathy. So just by being around water and exposed to water, increases our love, which he sees as twofold, compassion and empathy. So the bottom line is this. Water, exposure to water changes our brain chemistry. So it changes us for the better. It changes our overall well-being. So no wonder water was chosen for baptism. You know, they could have chosen something else for baptism, but it wasn't. It was water. So it makes total sense. So now think of this. When we are baptized, by the way, I have a whole different view of baptism after doing some research into this. So wouldn't it be cool if, knowing we are baptized, and maybe some of us in here are thinking this, that we feel all of this because we're baptized. Now we practice infant baptism. So it's hard for an infant to understand that, you know, but that exposure to water, even at a young age, it has its impact on infants. And so they're not really they're not aware that, oh, they feel safer, they feel energized or whatever. They don't understand that. And you know what? And even when we confirm our young people, I don't know that they really understand that either. They're They're confirming the promises we as adults made, but I don't know that they're really understanding the changing effects baptism has. Like, I really get now adult baptism. I really get why some churches practice adult baptism. Because that you feel it, you take it in, you have a better understanding, there's a maturity, there's a growth, whatever, that it all, for me, it's all come together now. The healing power of, and spiritually healing power of water. You know, Catholics use holy water all the time as well. You know, there's a reason for that. There's a scientific reason now for the benefits that water has. And when we are baptized, we're renewed. When the people came to be baptized at the Jordan River, and they came to be renewed, they came to have their sins washed away, you know, they came to feel new in some way. They wanted some type of life-changing experience. So John the Baptist was walking around baptizing people in the Jordan River, which was murky. You know, I said it here to the children, you know, when your hands are dirty and you pour water and the dirt comes off? Well, I understand the Jordan River, that probably didn't happen. They were baptized in the Jordan River and probably came out murky and muddy a little bit. But still a sense of cleansing through that baptism. The water, you know, Christ's Spirit, it comes to us through the water. The Holy Spirit comes to us in many ways. The water is one of the ways. It talked in the gospel lesson about a dove descended, and that is another way that the Holy Spirit manifests itself. The baptismal waters are regenerating. You know, we're kind of get away from our old selves, and it changes us in some way, even for that moment. Even for that moment, you know, sometimes if you just put your toes in the pool, that moment, it changes you in that instance. You might be having a bad day, and you put your feet in the water, or your feet in a creek or whatever, and at that moment, it changes you. At that moment, you feel some of this, which is what many of us need. We need more of this oftentimes. So, the waters don't only kind of drown out our old selves, but it regenerates us to recreate us as disciples of Christ. The thing that's interesting, though, sometimes that I think about, again, myself, is our baptism has the power to do all that, but do we surrender to allow it to do that for us? Do we actually surrender and hand that over? I'm going to assume that some of you have had experience like I did yesterday, where I'm just a bad moment, and I'm in tears, and I'm crying out to God, and I'm saying, why don't you just take this from me? And I'm not surrendering it. I'm saying, take it from God, but God's saying, you're still holding on, girl. I'm pulling, but you're holding on. You know, I'm doing my best here, but you're holding on. There's some things that you have a job to do, too. So that's the thing about, again, about baptism and looking at it now from adult eyes, is are we surrendering to experience all this for our baptism? Baptism changed those people, like I said, who in our gospel lesson came down to get baptized. They were looking for something. People at that time, the followers of John the Baptist, and they were hearing that they're, you know, God is sending his son, and they were looking for something. They were expecting something. They had a glimmer of hope for something. And so baptism was offering that for them as well. And then Jesus came along to be baptized. And some people would say, why should Jesus be baptized? Well, Jesus was a human being like us. And after that, the dove, the Holy Spirit came and said, this is my son. Like, that was an official moment to tell people, this is who we've been talking about, this is who we've been waiting for, here he is. Here is Jesus, my son. Almost like a wake-up call. And I imagine I start thinking, and I'm not going to go on and on about that here, but how did Jesus change in that whole of that experience? Because there it was officially announced to everybody, again, that this is my son, he is going to be your savior. I don't know how he felt about that. I mean, I'm sure he was changed a lot through that. Jesus was very devout to God's calling. Jesus surrendered. I mean, look at that at the end. He was on the cross. He was surrendering. He's like, here I am, you know. And we need to probably be a little more like that. But baptism, the water of the baptism, just changes us. Just, that's why I call this blue line baptism. This is what I think baptism has the ability to make for every one of us. When we open our hearts to Christ, we should be feeling this way. When we surrender, we should be feeling this way. That's what baptism can do for us. And it's proven scientifically that the water is going to do this. It's right there. And so sometimes I think we just need to consider that more. Consider our baptism and what are those promises, which we're going to look at in a minute or two. What are those promises that were made for us, and what are those promises that we affirmed when we were confirmed, and are we living those out? So can you bow your head in prayer, please? God, you are a mysterious God, and there are often times that many of us don't understand. But that water thing hits home. It is something that is tangible. It is something that we use every day. And it is probably a message or something that you put in our life daily to make us think of you and of your son Jesus, and how we can be renewed, we can have a rebirth, we can be regenerated through Christ and following Christ's examples and our belief in you and calling out to you when needed. So you really did know what you were doing with that water thing. Now we have proof of it. And thank you for that. May, as the days go on, there are many people that live lives that are dry, that are arid, that their hearts are hard, that need some water, that need some refreshing, that need some energizing, that needs to be calm and refreshed and all that. And may you use us to let them experience the power and the strength that the water has. Amen. Now I have to put everything back. So if you could return to your bulletin, we are going to take a time for remembering our baptisms, and there will become a time when I do talk about or ask the questions of you, that there's no response, no verbal response from you, that it will just be a time for you to reflect on those questions. So join us in our living for the blessing of the Lord. We thank you, God, for the gift of creation called forth by your saving word.
Shape and form, your spirit moved over.
brought forth the earth to sustain all life.
In the time of Noah, you washed the earth with waters of the flood, and you marked salvation for a new beginning.
In the time of Moses and Miriam, your people Israel passed through the Red Sea waters from slavery to freedom and crossed the flowing Jordan to enter the promised land.
Jesus was baptized by John in the water of the Jordan, became living water to a woman at the Samaritan well, washed the feet of the disciples, and sent them forth to baptize all nations by water and the Holy Spirit.
Blessed be the Holy Spirit, gracious God, this water that I am giving you now and for baptism into Jesus Christ, and that by the power of your Holy Spirit, we may be kept faithful until you receive us at last in your eternal home.
Glory to you, eternal God, one who was and is and shall always be, world without end. Amen. Do you promise by the grace of God to be a disciple, to follow the way of Jesus Christ, to resist oppression, to show love and justice, and to witness the work and word of Jesus Christ as best as you are able? And do you promise, according to the grace given to you, to grow in your faith and to be a faithful member of the church, celebrating Christ's presence and furthering God's mission in all the world? Eternal God, you have come to us in Jesus Christ, given us new birth by water and the Holy Spirit, and forgiven all our sins. Bless us now with the grace we need to fulfill what we have promised.
Keep us faithful to our Savior, Jesus Christ, forever and ever. Amen.
Please join me in the offering, prayer, and invitation. God of water, we worship this morning, grateful for the good things that fill our lives. But many of us carry within ourselves feelings of emptiness, unworthiness, disappointments, and failures. We desperately need to be reminded that in our baptism, as in the one Jesus received, there is an affirmation that we are claimed and loved by you, just as we are. If you could do more,
As you leave today, feel free to stop by the baptismal font, put your hands in there, play with the water. Just take a moment to reflect if you'd like to. But as our time of worship closes, our time for service in the world continues. Leave as spirit-filled people, ready to live out your baptismal faith. Go in peace to love and to serve. Amen.